come broken, move on, can. God, I fall.
Good morning. Y'all must have been busy this week. You're doing extra chores. Everybody's kind of quiet and all tired. We're going to get some energy going in here this morning. If you'll stand and sing with us, we're going to get started in worship. Let's go.
Oh. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight?
Here we go,
it was my tomb until I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you.
That's awesome. Hey, have a seat, everybody. We are so glad that you are here. Big week this week, 4th of July. I want to say happy 4th of July to you all from our staff. A special day today. Some of you already know this. You've been so sweet to say it. It is, I have to recognize it, it's mine and Debbie's 40th wedding anniversary today. I'm going to bring her up here because I just want to say how grateful I am. I was trying to think of some kind of biblical reference, but you know, the first one that came to mind was 40 years in the wilderness.
I love you.
For her, she was in the wilderness with me. But then I thought the other one would be this, 40 days on the mountain with God. How about that? That's the way I feel about our relationship and how much I love this girl right here. So go sit down now. That's enough. She does. I want to tell you about something that happened this week. The youth were here for Youth Week, and I got a text at night after they had had worship, and I was told that 8 of the youth committed their lives to Christ this week. Somebody clap for that. Isn't that amazing? And then I've heard maybe that even more have. So God is doing something amazing within our youth, also in our children. We got exciting things happening with them. So I'm just so glad that God is so active here at Park Avenue. We got some folks who have made the decision today to take their next step by joining the church. So I want to invite them up, Randy and Jackson. Let's see. All right. And where's Allie? Are Allie and Michael here yet? Oh, okay. Where are they at? Allie and Michael, here they come. Come on up, guys. This is Jackson. This is Randy Minter. And they've been around for a while. You've seen them around. But they've decided they wanted to make this next step and join. And so, come on up, guys. This is Allie and Michael Beers. And, yep, perfect. Good. Stand right here. Glad to see you guys this morning. So I'm going to ask you the two questions that I always ask of those who have come to join. And the first question is this: do you reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Yes. And will you support this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Yes. Then it's our pleasure to welcome you into the membership here at Park Avenue. So you need to get to know, if you don't know these folks, you need to get to know them. They are great people, and they're going to do incredible things here at Park Avenue. So we're excited that you're part of the family. Give them a round of applause if you would. Give me a hug. Pretty good, Michael. Thanks. Shake my hand. Shake my hand. There you go. Good job. Good job. Love you guys. Good. Okay. Now, would you just stand and greet those around you and wish them a happy 4th of July, and we'll continue to worship together.
Father, I want to know you. So, Father, I just want to know you. So, take the limits off of who I think you are. Sing that again, Father. So, Father, I just want to know you. So, take the limits off of who I think you are. And sing Jesus. I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are. So Jesus, I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are. 'Cause in you I find off of who I think you are. A spirit, I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are. So take the limits. So take the limits off of who I think you are. So take the limits. So take the limits off of who I think you are. Oh, 'cause in you I find
open ourselves up. I receive.
I receive, I receive, I receive it. And I receive, I receive, I receive it. And I receive, I receive, I receive it.
And I'm running towards your mystery.
And I believe, I believe, I believe it. I believe, I believe, I believe it. I believe, I believe, I believe it.
And I'm running towards your mystery. I receive.
I receive, I receive, I receive it. I receive, I receive, I receive it. I receive, I receive, I receive it.
Oh, and I'm running towards your mystery.
And I believe, I believe, I believe it. I believe, I believe, I believe it. I believe, I believe, I believe it.
And I'm running towards you.
In you I'm found.
Oh, all that I've ever needed. Oh, so would you overflow here? I receive you. Oh, in you I found. Oh, all that I've ever needed. Oh, God, so would you overflow here? 'Cause I receive your fullness.
We sing, Father, I just want to know you. Father, I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are.
Sing to Jesus.
So Jesus, I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are.
Welcome to Spirit here.
So Spirit, I just want to know you. So take the limits off of who I think you are.
So as we draw closer to God and take the limits off of who we see who he is, he opens us up to an amazing world where we want to glorify and praise him for all that he's done and his sacrifice. Would you sing with us?
The moon and stars, they walked. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen, and his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. Final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. The battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. As the ground began to shake, the storm rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Oh, now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Now forever he is glorified. Forever he alive. Oh, he is.
stone was rolled away, His perfect love could not be overcome. Now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King, oh, has rendered you defeated. Sing it out! Now, forever He is glorified. Oh, forever He is lifted high.
Why we sing is to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be all glory and majesty and dominion and authority. So before all time and now, we praise Him forever. And amen. We sing hallelujah to the risen one. And we sing. Oh, and we sing hallelujah.
To take the offering up, don't forget to fill out your communication card and drop it in the basket as it comes by. And while they're coming, I just want to tell y'all, the greatest day of my life is the day I realized that all of this was true. All of this was true. And there is a God and there is a Satan. And Jimmy's going to talk about that this morning. And y'all, this is a powerful Sunday for us. And I'm excited to get to be in the house of God today as we stand there and sing about our resurrected Lord who has overcome the evil one. That is good news for us today. And so that is my prayers, that we will take it in today, that we will understand, and that we will give worship back to God from that understanding, and that He will transform us today. Let's pray. God, we just thank You so much, because without You, we are nothing. But with You, we are beyond what we can even fathom or understand. God, all of this is true. This is not a fairy tale that we come to church and we sing about and we talk about. It's the truth. And it is the truth that sets us free to be free forever. God, I pray as we give to You this morning, that our hearts would be changed, that we would be moved, that we would be transformed, that we would come to a greater understanding of what it means to be Your child, saved by grace. Lord, may we fall more in love with You today than we have ever been in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. As soon as the song's over, the children can leave for children's church.
I've done before. It's a really cool song. It's little scary too, because I think it identifies a lot of things about us that we don't like to admit, or maybe we try to convince ourselves. But this is called Fear is a Liar, and fear is a analogy, I guess, for a change up for Satan. And that's what he's talking about in this song, is that fear is a liar. Satan wants to lie to us. He wants to trap us. He wants us to believe the worst things about ourselves and not believe the things that God wants us to know about who we are inside of him. And so as you're paying attention to this song this morning, it's going to tie really well, hopefully, into what Jimmy's going to talk about this morning. And as we move forward, just impact this song and see when these verses, if you're telling yourself some of these lies, and know that this is not who God wants you to be and who, what he wants you to think about yourself. When he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, and when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough. Take your breath and stop you in your steps. Fear is a liar. He will rob your rest and steal your happiness. Cast your fear in the fire, 'cause fear liar. When he told you you were troubled, you'll forever be alone. And when he told you you should run away, you'll never find a home. And when he told you you were dirty, and when he told you you could be the one that grace could never change, oh, fear is a liar. Oh, and he will take your breath and stop you in your steps. Fear is a liar. Oh, and he will rob your let your fire fall and cast out all my fears. Let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Let your fire fall and cast out all my fears. Oh, let your fire fall, your love is all I fear. Let your fire fall. He's a
fire.
Pray with me. God, so often we've bought the lie. Hook, line, and sinker. We act like it's the truth and we act on it and we let it, God, affect everything in our life that would have us choose you, and we think that we're not good enough for it. We think we don't deserve it. It freezes us in our tracks, God, and we don't know what to do. God, because we feel ashamed and we feel like us. God, maybe you can't fix us, that it works for everybody else but us. And we buy the lie. God, and that's when Satan wins. But God, you've been so clear. Your word has been so clear on who you are in us. God, that you win. God, that you have won. We've already sung today how you've overcome this death, this sin, this junk in our life. You have already overcome, and all of our strength and all of our power, all of our identity is inside of you. But God, if we could just believe that, like we sang earlier, God, I believe it. God, and it's going to change our life. It's changed my life because of everything you've done. God, I pray that every person in here can say that with confidence. I receive it and I believe it more than anything, more than I am. That we don't let Satan convince us of the things that aren't true. God, and we allow your strength, your word, your spirit to be the guide in our life that sets us up, God, to live for you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Because you had a bad day, you take one down, you sing a sad song just to turn it around. You say you don't know, you tell me don't lie, you work at a smile.
I just love it. I love it. Today we're wrapping up the curveball theme, though. So next we're going to pick up with a series that starts. It's called "How Good Is the Good News?" Kind of a great follow-up for today's message. So hope you'll be here next week as well. I'm going to talk to you today about the devil. Call him Satan. Call him Beelzebub. Whatever you want to call him. I'm going to talk to you about Satan. So here's what's going to happen during this message. Satan is going to try to deceive you, to distract you, and ultimately to destroy you, even as we gather here and meet. So the distraction part, I understand, because it's easy to get distracted during a message sometimes. So here's what I want you to do. I want to make sure that your neighbor is not distracted. So would you do this? Would you go ahead and elbow them and say, don't be distracted, just to get practice? Be ready. If you see that your neighbor is distracted, then you'll know it's not anything other than Satan trying to distract them. Peter, who was in the inner circle with Jesus, Peter understood the power of Satan, because there's a moment when Jesus actually calls him Satan. So he wrote about that, because he had experienced it and he knew what it was like. He knew the reality of it, and so he wrote about that. And it is a good word for us today. It comes from 1 Peter chapter 5. Just two verses. Follow along with me. It'll be up on the screen. Here you go. Here's what he says. Stay alert. That means don't be distracted. Don't be, focusing on other things. Then he says this. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. Now, notice what he calls him. He says he's a great enemy. This isn't just somebody who plays at it. This is a great enemy. And look what he does. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. So stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. And then he offers some encouragement, because they were under persecution and being suffered. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are. And so what I add to that is, you and I know that all of us face kind of the same struggles in life. And so we're all going through that at the same time. And there's some encouragement for us that we have the means to overcome it through Christ. So when I was a kid, I played a little bit of baseball. And I think I told you I was a catcher, which was not something I set out to do. And in fact, what happened was the catcher who was the starter was practicing one day before we had practice. And he was catching without his mask on. And a batter was up. And as the pitch was thrown, the catcher leaned into the pitch and got nailed in the back of the head. And so after that, he couldn't catch anymore. So the coach said, "Hey, does anybody else know how to or would like to be a catcher?" And I was the backup third baseman, so I knew I wasn't going to get a whole lot of playing. So I said, "I'll do it." And so I became a catcher. And as a catcher, I learned a lot of these, chance things that we would say back in the day, back in the 1900s when we were playing. And one of the things that we would say when a batter would come up, I don't know whether they still do this or not. I know there was a famous song written about it, but we would say things like this: "Swing, batter, batter, swing." Do you remember that? Anybody? Am I the only one that did that, or did y'all do it? Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. There are two old people in here other than me. But that's what we would say: swing, batter, batter. And so I remember that. I remember doing all of that. And then as we began to work with the youth, we went to some of the girls' softball games, and I was just blown away with all the noise that the players were making in the dugouts. I don't know if you guys play girls' softball, any of you here, and if it's still that way or not, but they were doing all these chants and these cheers, and it was just, I told somebody, we were sitting there watching the game, I said, "This is distracting. I don't understand. What are these girls doing? I was confused about it." Well, apparently some college teams do it, and others do it, and so this is kind of what it looks like. I got a few clips of some girls' softball teams doing some cheers. I want to show those to you. Let's watch this.
And then if we hit a double, we say the Dublin, 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 which is always fun.
What? Here we go. What? Dublin!
Wow. And so then I thought about, could you imagine if they brought that into like Major League Baseball? There you go. I think, don't you think that would be good? I'd like to see the Atlanta Braves doing that. Maybe they can start now. You know, you're good, we're good, you're bad. I think I told you, I remember when I was coaching T-ball and the kids would line up at the end of the game and they'd go down the line and they would say, "We'd won the game," and they're going down the line meeting the other guys and they're slapping hands, shaking hands with them. And they're like, "Good game, good game, good game." There's this one guy on the team, I think I told you, he would say, he'd go down there, "Good game, good game, good game, bad game, bad game, bad game. You're bad, you're bad, you're bad." I think he's doing time somewhere right now. One of the chants that we had when we were coming along was "Good Eye." Do you know that chant? It's like "Good Eye." It was like if you're a batter there's a close pitch. It's either close to being a strike or not a strike, but it's a ball, and you take that pitch. Then oftentimes the coach or the team, somebody would say, "Good Eye, Good Eye." And so that's what I named this message today was "Good Eye." A couple of weeks ago, I told you about batters who try to get hit by a pitch. You remember that? But here's the thing about good eye. Here's what it means. It means having a very good awareness, fill in that blank, of the strike zone. In other words, there's a certain little box. If you watch Major League Baseball now, you'll see the little imaginary box. And if it's in that box, it's typically called a strike. That's called the strike zone. And so a person with a good eye rarely swings at pitches outside of the strike zone, even though they're really close to being a strike. The more patient they are at the plate, the more likely they are with a good eye to have a base on balls, or we call it a walk. And so they get their first base, a free first base. And so, you know, I ask you about the person who was hit the most by baseballs for the major league. And I just wondered, who holds the major league career record for the most base on balls? I wonder if anybody here knows that. Anybody know who that is? What? Barry Bonds. Barry Bonds does. That's right. How in the world would anybody know that? I wonder how many walks did he have in his career, Barry Bonds. I wonder, anybody know? Anybody? Anybody? 2,558. He's exactly right. Oh my gosh, this is just amazing. So he also holds the record for the most walks in a season. It was 2004. Anybody know how many walks he had in that one season? 232. And so his career base on balls percentage was what? Anybody know?
26%.
Oh my gosh. I want him on my team. Way to go. Good job. Yeah. So here's the question. What kind of eye do you have? You know, we've been talking about life's curveballs that are thrown at us just because of life, circumstances, things that happen to us in life. We've talked about, you know, curveballs that sometimes God sends our way, maybe to get our attention, maybe to move us in a certain direction or to call us to something that we should be about. We've also talked about curveballs that we throw and how they can cause a foul in our lives. But we really haven't spent much time talking about Satan's role in throwing curveballs. So that's what I wanted to do today. We'll spend a little bit of time on that. Satan does throw curveballs, and his aim, his purpose, is to strike us out. He wants us off our game. He wants us out of the batter's box and defeated. And it started when he was in the Garden of Eden. He worked hard on it there, and he was successful with Eve and then with Adam. And then throughout the Old Testament, you'll see where evil and Satan is referenced. And then in the New Testament, you'll see it quite a lot. In fact, he tried to get Jesus off his game. Actually tried to get him to strike out when he tempted him in the wilderness. And so here's the thing about Satan. Satan is a master at this. He's had thousands and thousands of years of experience, and so he knows what he's doing. But before we're able to handle the curveballs he throws, then we need to know a little bit more about who he is and what he's capable of doing. And so here's where I want to start, because in my life as a minister, surprisingly, I've run into a number of people in church and outside of church who would say Satan's not real. In fact, I had a professor in my seminary who questioned that. And fortunately, I didn't receive what he was saying to us. But there are people who do not believe that the enemy is real. I want you to fill in that blank. The first thing is, the enemy is real. Satan is real. The Old Testament mentions him. We'll find references throughout the New Testament. I mean, all of the Gospels talk about him. Paul talks about him. Peter and James and John, the three for the inner circle with Jesus, they all write about Satan. It's crystal clear that Satan does exist. In fact, Jesus talked about Satan in the Gospels in red. He talked about Satan at least 23 times. That's a lot when he refers to it. And one of the places that he refers to it is in the Lord's Prayer. You know the Lord's Prayer, our Father who art in heaven. We pray that often. And one of the pieces of that is, deliver us from what? Do you remember? Deliver us from evil. In fact, if you'll go and search kind of the original Greek there, what you'll find in some translations is, it says, deliver us from the evil one. And that personalizes Satan. Jesus is saying, when you pray, every time you pray, some people would say, this is what you ought to pray, deliver us from evil or the evil one. Now, that's Jesus' instruction to us. But he didn't stop there. Listen to what he did later on as he's praying in the upper room. He's praying for the disciples and he's praying for us. And he says this in John 17:15. He says, I'm not asking you, Father, to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from, and here he uses that phrase, the evil one. He's talking about Satan. He's talking about the devil. Because Jesus knew what Satan could do. He had been tempted by him himself. He knew how real he was, and he knew how much the enemy wants to destroy us. And so Jesus said, pray these prayers. And Father, you protect them from him. So I don't know if you pray that prayer or not, but you should. You should pray, deliver us from evil. In fact, when we pray, Debbie and I pray for the church. I mean, one of the things that Satan does is he attacks churches. And so when we pray in the mornings for a lot of you that are on our prayer list and for our staff, we always pray for more of God here at Park Avenue, but also deliver us from evil. Do not let Satan find a foothold here, Jesus. So we start with the reality of the existence of Satan. Now, if you don't buy into that idea, I want you to know that you have been deceived already. Satan has deceived you. And I encourage you to study it and discover for yourself the reality of it. But now that we have talked about that, I want to talk about how he works. Because he has some key strategies and some plots and ploys that he uses to mess us up. And so here's the key strategy is this. It's just simply deception. He is a master at it. I want to tell you what deception is so that we understand it. Deception is the act of causing someone to accept as true or valid something that is untrue or invalid, something that is false or invalid. And so what he's trying to do is he's trying to convince us that something bad for us is actually good for us. And when we accept that idea and we step into that something bad, then it does exactly what he's trying to get us to do, and that's to separate us from God. It's called sin. If he can get us to sin, he is separating us from God. He is distracting us from what should be our focus with a good eye, and that focus should be Jesus Christ. I mean, that's been his strategy. That's what he did in the garden with Adam and Eve. That's what he did with Jesus in the wilderness. In fact, Matthew calls him, in his version of Jesus being tempted, he calls Satan the tempter. That's what he actually uses. And he worked Jesus over by tempting him to do certain things which appealed to Jesus' human nature, because Jesus was fully human and fully divine. And so here's how he tempted him, because he's still doing it to us, and we need to understand this. He tried three things. One was he tried to tempt him with control. And what he tried to do was he tried to get Jesus to trust in himself and not in the Father. And he does the same thing with us when he's like, you can handle this. This is about you. This is your desires and what you want. You know, it doesn't matter what God wants right here. It's all about you. And boy, doesn't culture and society support that. It's all about you. So control was the first thing. Then the second thing that Satan hits us with is he tempts us with physical wants and needs. And this goes to all kinds of things. I mean, it goes to sexual immorality. It goes to our desire for things of this world. And so he's a master at that. And then the third one is this. He will tempt us with emotional wants and needs. And here's what I mean by that. That's just the desire to be loved and to be respected. And I think of all the people who have fallen into that trap, and they've done things thinking that they would be loved and respected that they should have never done. And it's troubling. But Satan works here. That's what he wants to do. He's a master at deception and distraction. Paul was very concerned about the early Christians. He was afraid that they would be deceived. And so he wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 11. He wrote this to them. He said, I am afraid that your minds, that's where Satan works, your minds might be seduced in the same way as the snake deceived Eve with his devious tricks. You might be unable to focus, there's the eyes, focus completely on a genuine and innocent commitment to Christ. Do you see what he does? He distracts us. He wants to get us focused on something else other than this genuine and innocent commitment to Christ. And he's good at it. But we sang it just a minute ago. Satan is a liar. He is the master of lies. He will lie to us about who God is. He lies to us about how God feels about us. He lies to us about how we can use our freedom in God. He's a liar. and he's good at it. In fact, Jesus talked about that. Jesus named him. And here's what he said in John 8. He says this about it. He says, he's talking to the Pharisees and the religious leaders who are distracted, who are deceived, and are ultimately leading people to destruction. Here's what he said to them. He says, you, Pharisees, religious leaders, belong to your father, the devil. Now, that was a shock for the Pharisees and the religious leaders, because who did they think was their father? Who would they say? Father who?
Abraham.
Exactly right. And so now, here they're hearing Jesus himself say, no, your father's the devil. Watch what he says. He says, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he's a liar and the father of lies. That's who he is. And so how does he lie? Let me tell you, we sang about a few of them just a minute ago, but here's some of his lies that I just wanted to highlight today. First one is this: it's okay. You can do this. Others are doing it. Don't you want to fit in? Isn't that what this is about? I mean, you're going to be embarrassed and you're going to be left out if you don't do this. I mean, everybody's doing it. So if everybody's doing it, it must be okay, right? I mean, so we end up following what others are doing, even though we know somewhere inside the Holy Spirit is trying to say, don't do that. You know, you shouldn't do that. That's not right. That doesn't honor your Father in heaven. But we do it. And Satan says, it's okay to do it. And sometimes I've given into it. I believe all of us have. Here's some more lies that he shares with us. This one is a big one, that only what we can see and experience is actually real. He wants us to believe that you can't see God and you can't see Christ and you haven't experienced him personally, so, you know, he must not be real. All this spiritual realm and, you know, this divine nature and all this stuff, it's not real. It's not real. There's a whole, I don't know, bevy of, you know, teaching out there that suggests it's not real. And Satan says, if I can get you to believe it's not real, I've won. And he's right. So even for believers, though, those of us who believe that heaven is a reality, the spiritual realm is an actual reality, here's the truth of the matter. Sometimes we don't act like it. We don't live like it's real. And that's where Satan's got a foothold. And Satan works hard right there to convince us that it's not real. If you can't experience and you can't see it, it can't be real. And he's a liar. But then he'll do little things like this. He'll do things like this. He'll say, what are you praying about that for? It doesn't work. I mean, you've been praying about this for a while. Nothing's ever happened. Prayer doesn't work. Why are you wasting your time? God doesn't really care about you. He's got too many other things to worry about. Besides, he doesn't want to hear from you anymore. Not after you've ignored him as long as you have. It's like, he's probably right there. You know, I have ignored him. I should have been talking to him all along, but it's been months since I've prayed, years since I've prayed. God wouldn't listen to me. And so Satan's telling you that, not God, because God's saying, come to me, talk to me. I would wrap my arms around you if you would just speak to me. I love you so much. Come to me and talk to me. Satan says he wouldn't want to hear from you. And then he has these other lies. God couldn't possibly love you. Just look at your life. It's a mess. How could God love somebody like you? And we hear that. And we say, that makes sense. Because we're used to the way people love each other, not the way God loves. I mean, how could God love me in my mess? Or this next one, it's a big one for a lot of us. God couldn't possibly forgive you. Look at what you did. How could anybody forgive you for that? And so Satan tries hard to get us to believe something that is false is actually true. And we need to be aware of it. We need to have that good eye so that we can see the strike zone in our lives, the areas where he's trying to hit us, and we can watch and be ready to defend it. So you may think, well, I hear all that, but not me. I'm pretty sharp. He can't deceive me. Well, he can too. Let me tell you how I know that. Because if Satan can use and deceive Peter, the rock, he can deceive anyone. And that's you and me. I mean, that story that we know of Peter in the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, where he's talking to Jesus. Jesus is talking to the disciples, and Jesus says this. He says, okay, we need to go to Jerusalem now. Because Jesus knew what was going to happen in Jerusalem. And his whole goal, his whole heart was, I'm going to Jerusalem to die. That's what it was all about. And he told the disciples that over and over, and they kept scratching their heads saying, I don't get it. That doesn't make sense. Surely you're not going to do that. So there's one time when Jesus says, we're going to Jerusalem. And Peter pulls him aside, and you know what Peter does? The scripture actually says in one translation, it says, or one of the gospel accounts, it says that he pulled Jesus aside and rebuked Jesus. Now, how many of you have ever tried to rebuke Jesus? I mean, that's powerful. He's saying, Lord, you got to stop talking like this because you're scaring me and the others. They're scared. We can't go to Jerusalem. And so Jesus said those famous words to him, get thee behind me, Satan. Do you hear what he's doing? He's calling Peter Satan. Get thee behind me. You are a stumbling block to me, Jesus. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. And so if Satan can use Peter, one of the closest friends Jesus had during his time in ministry, then he can use any of us. So anytime we don't have in mind the concerns of God, then Satan is making headway with us. We're allowing him to use us. But we got to have a good eye. We got to have a good eye. Remember what Peter said. He said, stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy because he's prowling around looking for somebody to devour. So he's going to try to deceive us. He's going to try to distract us. And ultimately, he wants to destroy us. He does not want us to go to heaven. He does not want us to have a relationship with God. He does not want us to have good marriages. He does not want us to have good jobs where there is a healthy environment, where we allow Christ to have a presence at our place of work. He does not want us to have a school where God has a presence. That's his game. That's what he wants to do, to deceive, to distract, to destroy. And some of his deception and lies that are at the are the heart of the way he works. And he just has this quiver full of all these tactics. I don't know if you've ever read C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters. You should read it if you haven't. It's really an interesting. If you like C.S. Lewis, you'd love to read this. But it's actually as though the demons are talking to each other. And so they've got all these ploys, these things that they're doing to try to mess up the Christians, those believers. They call them the great enemy. And so I saw where somebody went through that book and they laid out 100 different tactics that Satan uses. And essentially, I can give you the whole list. You should have it. If you want it, email me, text me something, I'll send it to you. But I wanted to share just a few of these. Look at these. These were 7 that I came up with. The first is this. He wants to get us to deny the existence of the spiritual war. We talked about that one already, that it doesn't really exist because you can't see it and you can't experience it. 2, he wants to get us concerned not with what is true or false, watch this, but with what is trendy. It's the latest thing. I mean, you just watch culture and watch what culture does. Culture shapes Christianity more than Christianity shapes the culture sometimes. And then he wants to keep us from praying. We know that. He wants to lull us into lukewarm complacency. Boy, have I ever seen that one. Oh, my gosh. Surely you have, too. It's like people, whatever. It's okay, whatever. You know, I don't care. And then the 5th one was this. He wants to isolate us from experienced Christians. He wants to get us alone so that he can take advantage of us and we're easy prey in that place. He wants to use, this is a big one, domestic tension. Wow. Man, I don't know if you've had that experience. I mean, Debbie and I have been married 40 years. We don't want you to think it was all unicorns and rainbows. It's been pretty close to it, though, honey, right? But he will take that tension in the relationship that should be the strongest relationships we have, and he will explode it in a heartbeat. That's what he does. That's one of his tactics. If I can get them divided, man, I can divide the whole team. And so he uses that. Here's another. He wants to keep us attending church. Watch that. Come to church, but then just spiritually drift. Just ease on out here. Let's be distracted. Let's focus on other things. You know, okay, well, I was at church. I'm doing the main things. Isn't that good enough, Lord? And he'll tell you, the Lord will say, yeah, that's good enough. Because he's a liar. So his first ploy is to get us to believe he's not real. We have to have a good eye. And the closer we are to Christ, the better our eyesight gets. The better our eye is, because the Holy Spirit will warn us. He'll come in and he'll say, hey, watch out here. You need to be careful. This is, and he'll ask this beautiful question. Because when a thought comes to mind, you should ask the question this, especially if it's something that's a little bit troubling, you feel a little bit awkward about it, a little bit unusual about it. You would say something like this, well, is this from God or is this from Satan? Let me just suggest, if it's for your good, your genuine good, it's not going to be from Satan. It's going to be from God. If it's something that you know is going to cause you some, you know, uneasiness, and you just don't feel right about this, but I think maybe I should. You should know that's not from God. That's from Satan. That's what he wants to do. He wants to get you to believe that it's okay when it's not. And so the closer we are to Christ, the better we're going to be able to recognize these tactics of Satan. I was interested to hear a mom talk about a conversation she had with her son, little son. And they were in the car riding one day home from school or something. And it was right after one of these terrible shooting incidents, mass shootings that happened. And there was a time when we just had those things almost every week there for a good while, a couple of years back. And so the child said to the mom this. She said, Mom, it sure looks like the devil is winning. It looks like the devil's winning. And she was like, you know, son, I understand it does. But he doesn't win. He's not a winner. He's not going to win this. He may make some headway here and there, but you've got to believe that Christ wins. He does. And that's really good news for us, because here's the third thought I had. You and I have the authority to eject Satan from the game. I really like that. You may not like that so much, but I thought it was kind of cool. We're talking about, you know, ball games and all, and the managers get ejected or the players get ejected because they did something inappropriate. I mean, we literally have the authority to eject Satan from interfering in our lives. That is really good news. James said it this way. He said, James, the brother of Jesus, said, therefore, submit to God. You want to make sure you have your eye on God. You're following Christ. You're with him close. Resist the devil, and he will run away from you. You see that? If you just resist him, he's going to flee. But I like the way the message said it. The message said this, so let God work his will in you. Then look at this. Yell a loud no to the devil and watch him scamper. I like that. Do you know that you have the authority to rebuke the devil? You have the authority, if you are in Christ, to tell the devil to leave you and your family alone, to leave your finances alone, to leave your work alone. Satan, you have no place here. And you declare it. You say it out loud. I do that at times. Satan, you have no authority here. You have no power over me. I am in Christ, so therefore be gone. In the name of Jesus Christ, be gone. And he flees because he cannot resist that. It's been our promise from God. And so I liked what Paul wrote when he was teaching us about the armor of God. He's telling us, you've got everything you need to defeat the devil. And watch what he says. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against, you could underline, all strategies of the devil. Not some, all. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world. That's the devil. Against mighty powers in the dark world. Those are those who follow the devil. And against the evil spirits in the heavenly places. Those are his demons. I mean, that's who we're fighting against. That's the reason there's so much trouble in the world today. It's because of Satan's effort. So therefore, he says, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. So we've got the power. You know, the devil wants me to strike out. He wants you and me to strike out. But Christ gives us the power to overcome. That's what we sang just a little while ago. So here's Satan. You can imagine you're up to bat. Maybe it's something that's happening in your life right now, and you've got a choice, and here comes the pitch. And you can just hear Satan saying, swing, batter, 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 swing. Like that's going to convince you to swing at a bad pitch. He wants you to strike out as a husband, as a father, as a mother, as a wife. He wants you to strike out as a co-worker, as a student, as a young adult, as a as a not-so-young adult. He wants to send you and me to the dugout, broken and defeated and ashamed of the effort that we've made. That's his desire. But he doesn't win. Christ does. Satan has no authority over you and me. You are not his. You and I are Christ Jesus. We're his, the Lord of all the world and the universe, Jesus Christ. And it's his power. It's his love for us that gives us the ability to resist the devil. And when we resist him, he will flee. He will flee. So, anybody get distracted? Go ahead and elbow him if they did. That's what he was trying to do. Don't be distracted. Don't be deceived. Do not be destroyed. Here's some next steps for you this week. I will be aware of the reality of the devil. You need to be more conscious of it. You and I both do. We need to be aware that he's at work right now. He will work in the coming week, tomorrow, maybe on the way home from here. He will be at work in your car. I will stay close to Christ. The closer we are to Christ, the more we have the ability to resist the devil. I will rebuke the devil. Like I said, speak it out loud. He has no authority here when he tries to deceive you. But look at the next one. The next one is, I will commit my life to Christ so that I have the power to overcome the devil's tactics. You know, I mentioned that we had some youth this past week commit their lives to Christ. Do you know what they have now because they did that? They have all of this power that we just talked about, all of this ability to overcome Satan. I just want to encourage you, as I try to do every week, if you have not made that commitment, make it today. Otherwise, you're going to struggle, and the devil's going to have you striking out and me striking out. So if you haven't made that commitment, make that commitment today and see how God uses that. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. It's really good news. I mean, we come and we hear about the devil and we sense that he's at work in our lives, but we can trust and believe today that because of your love for us and the power of Christ's work on the cross, that the devil doesn't win. And we don't have to let him have his way in our lives. All we have to do is stand firm and resist him. And he'll flee. Because you are so magnificent. You are so powerful. You are so good, God. And you are so present in us, if we follow you, that Satan has no authority. And so help us to believe that. Help us to live it out. And help us to thank you daily that you deliver us from evil. We love you so much, Lord. We're so grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just stand and sing with us as we close our service. Take a moment. If you want to spend time in prayer, the altar over singing, you're more than welcome. Otherwise, we want you to sing along with us this morning.
The
fading. Oh, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Nothing good have I, for nothing good have I, were I thy grace to claim. And so I'll wash my garments white, oh, in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. And Jesus paid it all to him I owe. And sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Well, so glad you guys were here. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't swing batter batter. Don't swing batter batter. Don't let Satan strike you out. We love you. Have a great week and a great 4th of July.
So pray.